I'm going to show you how to make this map in ArcGIS Pro, inspired by the work of Marie Tharp and Heinrich Berann. In the middle of the last century, the geological consensus was that Earth's crust was stationary, fixed. There was a relatively recent theory that Earth's crust was dynamic and that continents would drift over time. This idea was considered fringe and generally derided. But ocean floor soundings collected by Bruce Heason and assembled by Marie Tharp began to paint in a lively, dynamic surface. Marie saw a geologically active seafloor, spreading and subducting. She steadfastly challenged the consensus and advocated for continental drift. Her ideas were even dismissed as girl talk. But the evidence was just too compelling, and in a relatively short period of time, the consensus flipped. This map, painted by Heinrich Berann in collaboration with Marie Tharp, was printed in the October 1969 edition of National Geographic. We'll honor that spirit of truth and boldness by making a map reminiscent of this seminal work. Hopefully it's reminiscent, anyway. Let's take a look at some of the defining characteristics of this map. It uses a planimetric oblique perspective, which is not quite 3D, but 2D, with feature elements popping up off the 2D surface as though they were 3D. There's no distance foreshortening, but it's got a true-to-life tactile charm, a little bit trippy, 2.5D. The shadows indicate a northeast light source, somewhere around 15 degrees or so. And somewhat impossibly, the highlights indicate a light source down in the southeast. This is the kind of thing you can do when you're painting a map. Multiple light sources give an exquisite sense of terrain. We'll keep this in mind. Our first step will be to get our hands on some amazing bathymetric data. The wonderful folks at GEBCO coordinate with all sorts of data providers and make seafloor elevations available to everyone. I'll select this area around the Hawaiian Ridge and download it as a geotiff, because I love geotiffs. 28 megabytes, not bad. Sometimes I imagine people like Marie Tharp being transported into the current time and seeing the data and tools that are available to us. It's fun for me. And next, I'm going to download a special terrain toolbox from my friend and colleague Ken Field. Public figure? Anyway, it's a great collection of tools to visualize terrain in different ways. One of them is called oblique. That's what we're looking for. This specific tool was developed by Boyan Shaurich, Bernie Yenny, and Tom Patterson. I'll download the whole toolbox and unzip it. And here in ArcGIS Pro, I'll open the View tab and add the toolbox to my project by clicking the Catalog pane, right-clicking this Toolboxes option, and choosing Add Toolbox, and then I just navigate to wherever I saved it. And if I pop open this toolbox to take a look inside, there's so many great things. We'll be focusing on plan oblique. Let's take a look at this GEBCO data we downloaded. I'll zoom into the Hawaii area. This is called a digital elevation model. The deeper areas are black, the lighter areas are white, and everything in between is, you know, like in between. This geotiff is in the WGS84 coordinate system, and the tool requires that it be a projected coordinate system. I found an easy way of reprojecting an image is just to export it and then define the projection of the new image there. So I'll right-click the image and choose Export Raster. I'll update its name to Projected, and I'm going to keep it as the TIFF format because I like it. And here is where I can define the projected coordinate system that I want to use. In this case, I'm just going to use Web Mercator, I'm sorry. It's a rectangular projection, so the image won't rotate. And if I ever want to tile this up for ArcGIS Online, I'm all set. I'll make the clipping geometry the same as the input image. For pixel type, it's best to use the same pixel type as the input image. So I'll right-click my input image and take a look. In the Source tab, you can see its raster information. If I scroll down, I see, aha, 16-bit. And 16-bit signed. Signed because I have negative values, because I have an underwater bathymetry layer. Now I have a version of my bathymetry in a projected coordinate system, and I can get rid of this original one. Now it's time to fire up that mysterious plan oblique tool. Let's see what this can do. I'll point it at my newly projected bathymetry data, and I'll give it an output name. Now you have to keep this short. I think it has to be like under 16 characters. I don't know what, but keep it short. I remember there's a thing with that. The inclination angle controls how extreme the 2.5D effect is. 90 degrees, there's no effect, you're looking straight down. 0 degrees, you're just looking at the horizon and everything's mountains. I'm gonna do 5 degrees, pretty extreme. This tool works by essentially smearing higher elevation pixels up in the Y dimension. And the results are really cool. You can even see just from this elevation data, the sense of 3D-ness. But technically, we're still in 2D space. And now I'm done with this input layer, so I can delete that one. I'll open the symbology panel for this, and I'm going to change its pixel stretch to standard deviation. I'm going to do this for every derived image in this whole project. Oh, and I can delete these original base map layers. I'm finished with them. And now it's time for some downright magic. I'm going to calculate a hillshade layer based on this oblique elevation layer, and I'll find it in the imagery tab, raster functions. Within the surface category, I'll choose hillshade. Of course, I'll point it at my only option, which is our newly obliquified elevation layer. Azimuth means the direction of your imaginary light source, which I'll make 15 degrees. Let's see what we get. Ooh, this is intriguing, but first I need to open up the symbology for my new hillshade layer and give it a stretch type of standard deviation. This just means that we're statistically distributing the tones of our hillshade. And it's just gorgeous, a north by northeast light source. I'll tidy up the name here and just call it hillshade. I'm gonna make a copy of this layer by holding the control key and dragging. And for this copied layer, I'm just gonna tweak the formula that made its hillshade by right-clicking it and choosing Edit Function Chain. In this view, I can see my input layer and my hillshade function. I'm gonna insert a little blur step between these two steps. It's got kind of a weird name, but it's called statistics. I'll drag this into my formula, I'll connect it to my input image, and then I'll connect the blurring step to the hillshade step. And I can make this look tidy with this little button here. Boop. I'll open up the settings for this statistics function and give it a blur window of 6 pixels by 6 pixels. This is a way of generalizing our terrain before we apply a hillshade. If you've ever seen a photograph of me, you'll know that sometimes detail is the enemy of beauty. And now if I run this again, our second hillshade layer will be a more generalized sense of the overall terrain, less detail. Of course, I'll give it the old stretch type of standard deviation, and I'll rename it to hillshade blur. So here's our two hillshade layers, detailed hillshade and generalized hillshade. I want this generalized hillshade to have that bluish gray color gradient, like from the original map. I'll expand the gradients and choose Format Color Scheme to make my own custom color scheme. So I'll add 3 more color stops, and then I'm going to define these 5 colors like so. You can define a custom color for each of these color steps by choosing Color Properties. And it took me some pushing and pulling, I'll admit, but eventually I got something that echoes our source map. And if you ever get a gradient whose in-between colors are pretty funky, just switch its algorithm to linear. And I'll disperse these color stops so that I get a lot of nuance in the mid-ranges, and I save the highlights and the deepest shadows for the very end of the gradient. And of course, there's just something right about seeing bathymetric terrain in shades of blue. And now I'm gonna turn on my original crispy hillshade and give it a blend mode of soft light. Soft light will bake the tones of the crispy hillshade into the colors and tones of the more generalized hillshade. I like this a lot, but I feel like it's too saturated. So I'm gonna make a duplicate version of this. I'm gonna give it no blend mode. So I just have that grayscale hillshade, but I'm gonna make it 60% transparent. And I think we're getting closer to that vintage print look from the original map. But it's a bit flat and we're lacking a sense of depth, so I'm gonna drag the original oblique depth data layer to the top, and I'll give it a blend mode of soft light. And this adds a beautiful sense of depth. I like it so much, I'm gonna duplicate this layer, and the result is twice as cool. Now we're cooking. We've got 2 layers of hillshade and hypsometric tinting based on depth. But we're still missing that warm light source from the lower right. Let's see what we can do about that. I'm going to create yet another hillshade layer. This time, I'll place the imaginary sun at 120 degrees, which is southeast. I'll name my new hillshade layer Highlights, and I'll set its stretch type to standard deviation. And I'm gonna get into some more custom gradient shenanigans. I'll bookend this gradient with transparent white on each end, and I'll add 4 color stops, and I'll sandwich 2 Sahara sand colors in between. And to nestle this shimmery, sandy highlight layer into our underlying bathymetry, I'm going to give it a blend mode of, you guessed it, soft light. To review, we have a highlight layer from the southeast. We're using our depth layer as a hypsometric tint. Twice. We've got a grayscale hillshade layer at 60% transparent to give it that vintage desaturated look. And we're blending a crisp hillshade layer into a colorized general hillshade layer. Next, I'd like to replicate for this digital map the charming folds you get from an actual paper map. Living Atlas has a bunch of different paper textures, including folded. I'll add a new layer, and from Living Atlas, I'll search for paper texture, and there's a whole bunch of them here. There's folded paper texture. I'll add it. I'll drag this texture all the way up to the top and use a blend mode called color burn to bake in the dark creases. I'll duplicate this layer and then give this other one a blend mode of screen so that the highlights pop out. That way I get the best aspects from the shading and highlights from this creased paper texture. Next, I'll create a layout that fits a typical monitor, 19.2 inches wide by 10.8 inches tall. It's the same aspect ratio as a 1920 by 1080 monitor. Then I'll insert my map frame, snap to the edges, and adjust the scale. Something I always like to do with layouts is get rid of the default black border around the map frame. But what about land? Right now the Hawaiian Islands are covered in blue water. I'll add a US states layer from Living Atlas. I'll undo its default transparency so it's fully opaque. Because that plan oblique tool artificially smeared higher elevations up in our view, it no longer lines up with correctly positioned layers, like this layer of Hawaii. So I'll have to artificially bump Hawaii up to match the coastline of our oblique elevation layers. And yes, this is a complete hack. Via the symbology panel of this land layer, I'll give it a global effect of move, and then I'll just nudge it up in the Y direction until it lines up pretty much with our elevation content. Two wrongs make a right, kinda. Conveniently, this light orange color is actually perfect. I just need to give it a color blend mode to cook it into the underlying hillshade tones. The reason I saved this until after I had made a layout is so that my zoom wouldn't change. If I were to zoom in or out right now, it wouldn't line up anymore and I have to change this offset hack. I hope you give this a try. I hope you learn about and feel inspired by Marie Tharp and Heinrich Berann. You can reveal the stunning terrain of the seafloor. You can make maps that ask questions and challenge convention. You can have fun. You can reveal beauty. You can make